2 minutes remaining in our warm-up period. 2 minutes. The mountain top, walk on water. I got power, feel so royal. 1 second, I'ma strike for you. Diamond, platinum, no more for you. That adrenaline, never giving in. Giving up's not an option, gotta get it in. Witness, I got the heart of 20 men. No fear, go to sleep in the lion's den. That glow, that spark, that crown. You're looking at the king of the jungle now. Stronger than ever, can't hold me down. 100 miles feeling from the pitcher's mouth. Straight game face. Regional directors and finalists, please clear the court at this time. Good afternoon and welcome to Wintrust Arena for the 2022 Elks Hoop Shoot National Finals. Beside me is National Finals Contest Manager Vern Larson, also known as Mr. Rules. I am Dennis Sabo, and we're your announcers for the Elks Hoop Shoot National Finals. On behalf of the Elks National Foundation and more than 750,000 Elks across the country, we thank you for being here this afternoon. The road to Chicago ends now. You're about to witness the top 12 to 13-year-old free throw shooters in the nation compete for the title of national champion. The top boy and top girl in this division will have their names and pictures displayed in the Naismith Memorial Basketball Hall of Fame in Springfield, Massachusetts, the birthplace of basketball. Now let me turn it over to my partner, Mr. Rules, Vern Larson.
Thanks, Dennis, and good afternoon, everyone. To make the contest more enjoyable for everyone, we ask that all Hoop Shoot fans follow these rules. Rule number one, right now, everyone take out your cell phone and turn it to silent. Keep it that way throughout the contest. We encourage you to use phones or tablets to follow our online shot tracker or tweet about the contest. But we don't want to hear you using them. Speaking of silence, that brings me to rule number two. We ask that you respect the finalists and try to be as quiet as possible. Once the gym doors close, there will be no exiting or entering the gymnasium. Rule number three, no flash photos. You may take pictures, but please turn off your... especially in
Hello, everyone. Welcome back to WinTrust Arena. I'm Jim O'Kelly with the champ, Lakyn Boltz, and we are at the 2022 Elks Hoop Shoot National Finals. We got our signature events right now, the 12-13 division.
And, Jim, it's been quite a day so far. We had an entertaining morning, a great 10- and 11-year-old group, and then some halftime entertainment.
Yep. And we got just these last two contests. We're going to be following the 12-13-year-old girls. We have in the field of 72 national finalists this year. There are four former champions, and two of them are shooting in the 12-13 girls division. On the boys' side, it's going to be dandy as well. We have last year's first and second place finishers, and the boys 10 and 11 are back to do it again. We will try to follow that action on the boys' side. If you want to watch only the boys' contest, we suggest you go over to our Facebook page, Elks National Foundation. You will find a live stream of that contest without commentary.
So, again, we had a lot of experience in the 10- and 11-year-old group. Same thing here. They know what they're doing. They've been there, done that, is what I keep saying, and know what they're getting into.
Yep. We have four returning finalists on the girls' 12-13 side. As I mentioned, two former champions in 2019. Bree Bessonin of Michigan won the girls' 8-9 division that same year. Inu Wang of Florida won the girls' 10-11. Bree...
see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight for the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming, and the rockets' red glare, the bombs bursting in air, Gabriel through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say does that star-spangled banner yet wave o'er the land of the free and the home of the
from the state of Washington, Virginia Basil, ladies and gentlemen. And now, are you ready to make some noise and give a shout out to the 24 most amazing 12 and 13-year-old kids that you have ever seen shoot free throws, ladies and gentlemen? We are going to introduce you to them right now, starting with the girls, 12-13. From Carmi, Illinois, lodge number 1652, Miss Addie Elliott. Representing Great Falls, Montana, number 214, give it up for Cadence Graham. From Lamar, Colorado, lodge number 1319, Abrielle Gomez. From Harrison, Arkansas, 2311, it's JC Halitska. Representing Beaumont, Texas, lodge number 311, make some noise for Maddie Holmes. From Yuma, Arizona, lodge number 476, give it up for Jada Bosch. From Woonsocket, Rhode Island, number 850, next contestant, Ryan Sheehan. from Weehawken, New Jersey, lodge number 1456. Put your hands together for Kaya Pomeranz. Representing Crossburg, Maryland, number 470, it's Savannah Alt. All the way from Copper Country, Michigan, lodge number 404, make some noise for Bree Bessonen. From Boca Raton, Florida, number 2166, it's Inu Wang. And from Corvallis, Oregon, lodge number 1413, give it up for Kinsey Wark. And now for our 12, 13-year-old boys from Howell, Michigan, lodge number 2168, Mr. Dawson DeRocher. From Decatur County, Tennessee, number 2641, give it up for Jack Couples. Representing Marietta, Georgia, number 1657, Brendan Smith. Hailing from Columbus, Nebraska, and representing Lodge 1195, Alex Steffensmeyer. From Pierre, South Dakota, number 1953, make some noise for Eddie Duffy. From West Des Moines, Iowa, number 2752, Maxwell George. Representing Utica, New York, number 33, it's Tommy Goodell. From Sepulpa, Oklahoma, number 1118, Jackson Jones. Representing Nampa, Idaho, number 1389, Samuel Bauer. All the way from Kona, Hawaii, number 2616, give it up for Keikane Manuia. And from Weymouth, Braintree, Massachusetts, our next contestant representing 2232, Cole Madden. And contestant number 12 for the boys from Morgantown, West Virginia, lodge number 411, make some noise for Matthew Brown, ladies and gentlemen. Scorers and floor judges and rebounders, the contest may begin. We wish good luck to all 24 of our contestants.
Okay, that was Dennis Sabo, the contest announcer, and here we go. We're expecting barn burners on both sides of the gym.
What a cool introduction that all these kids get. That is awesome. With their trading card also showing up on the big screen.
The boys, like, they're fired up and ready to go. That looks like Dawson DeRocher stepping to the line, and we will be following the girls' side with our first shooter, Addie Elliott, from Carmi, Illinois Lodge, number 1652.
And now these 12 and 13-year-olds have had a lot of time today to sit and relax and wait for their turn to shoot. So we'll see if there's any nerves or kind of what the emotion looks like.
So each contestant can choose to shoot between 0 and 5 warm-ups for their first set of 10 shots. Before they start shooting for score, the line judge will make eye contact with each of the scorers, and that's how we will know that the buckets count. Here we go. Addie Elliott looking to set the pace. Put the pressure on our opponents. Lakyn, you always preferred to shoot at the beginning, right?
Absolutely. I never wanted to be towards the end of the line. You have to sit there and watch everybody else sink all their shots. And I wanted to be in Addie's position here where I was making everybody else behind me just a little nervous, hopefully.
Lakyn was a 3-time national finalist, 2006, 2007, and 08. She won it all as an 8-9-year-old, her second year of hoop shoot competition. Finished fifth in the 10-11 girls the next year, and then bounced back for a second place finish in 08.
So it was cool kind of winning it in 06. If you guys don't know, the winner of each age group, boys and girls, gets their name in the James Naismith National Basketball Hall of Fame out in Springfield. And when I competed, we were out in Springfield, not here in Chicago. And in order to see your name, you had to basically just make it back. And so when I won in 06 as a 9-year-old, I knew, hey, I want to get back out there and see this. And sure enough, made it back when I was 10 and 11 and came back with a couple different trophies.
Yeah, now we fly the top six winners out so they can see their name digitized at the Elks Hoop Shoot display in the Basketball Hall of Fame. So Addie just gave her competitors a pretty rude welcome to the state of Illinois. Cadence Graham shooting second from Great Falls, Montana Lodge, number 214. Her sister, Ellison, just shot in the 10-11.
So the Graham family is no stranger to the hoop shoot, and Cadence is stepping up. I'm sure she knows well what she's getting into.
She got to, cheer on her sister in 2019, and then in the virtual conclusion last year. But this is her first appearance at the national finals as a competitor.
And, you know, we've mentioned here in the previous age groups, the failure part of it is such a huge lesson in within itself. You know, for those that don't get the chance to make it to nationals, of course, I'm sure it gives you a little bit of fire going back into the next year. Of course, it did for me.
Yep. Teaches one thing you the hoop shoot allows you to confront failure. See how high you can bounce after losing. And it's really great motivation for these competitors.
It definitely teaches at such a young age that if you want to achieve something, you have to work for it. And I think Cadence is wearing a t-shirt that says consistency is key or something like that. So I'm sure the Graham family, it's ingrained in them. Nothing beats commitment. There we go.
It takes a lot of commitment to get here. A lot of time spent in the gym. Lakyn, and I know when you were a hoop shooter, you were shooting at least 200 free throws a day.
Yep. And that's what it takes, honestly. I mean, I was in third grade, and Dad was picking me up from elementary school every afternoon. And while other kids were maybe going off and playing and doing other things, we headed to the high school gym. And I was fortunate to have the high school coaches there. They would actually move their high school basketball practice on the court so I could have a main hoop. And so I, you know, obviously owe a lot to my parents for their dedication to rebounding and stuff like that back in the day, but also there were a lot more people that went into it.
Yeah, I'm sure there were plenty of times when there were lots of other things you would have rather been doing than shooting those 200 free throws.
Yeah.
But that's what commitment and dedication is all about.
Well, and it's kind of funny to think back, like, you know, the people around me at school never really understood why I was heading to the high school every single day to shoot baskets. And now looking back, it just kind of shows you again what that commitment does.
This is Abby Gomez from Lamar, Colorado Lodge, number 1319. Yeah, and the wonderful thing about that commitment, dedication, practice, and hard work is you start to see the results, and it's not lost even on the 8-9-year-olds like you were when you first got started with the hoop shoot. You see yourself getting better, and you realize that, you know what, I could do better on my math test if I study a little bit more, and so on. It applies to other aspects of your life than just basketball.
Absolutely. You know, I definitely credit a lot of my experience from the hoop shoot to, you know, set myself up as who I wanted to be as a student athlete. And as a student in general, things that I learned at such a young age definitely paid off, whereas other kids might not have had that chance to go through those experiences, to experience failure, to know that if you want something, you're going to have to work for it. And the hoop shoot provides just that. So the kids experience it at 8 and 9, I mean, that's invaluable right there.
Well, a bucket here would be invaluable for Abby, and she got it. She finishes that first set of 10 with a 7. And here comes JC Halitzka, one of our four returning national finalists. She was in Chicago in 2019, the last year prior to this one that we had an in-person national finals. Finished in a four-way tie for second with a 21, and then finished after that shoot-off fourth overall, hitting 4 or 5 in the shootout. Looks locked in.
And it gets interesting now with this age group is 12 and 13 year old girls, like, and boys, you're probably at the point where if you play basketball, you might be playing some traveling basketball. I know some of these kids are on AAU teams, and you know, spoke with one parent where they were skipping out on an AAU tournament to come here, or you know, so it's like they're used to shooting free throws probably in game-like situations, but this is just a tad bit different.
I think the hardest thing to get used to is the total silence in the gym. All you hear is the dribbles, no more than four, and then the ripple of the net, or sometimes the clank of iron. But we haven't heard a whole lot of clinks yet in this division. Right on cue, but she made it.
And we've touched a little bit on the fact that we're, you know, shooting in such a big arena. It's probably not like the gym that they're used to practicing in at home, where you might have a wall right behind you. Is we now have arena seats behind the baskets and can maybe be a little bit difficult to adjust to, but so far we haven't had too many issues.
So JC just matched Addie at 10. This is Maddie Holmes, sponsored by Beaumont Texas Lodge, number 311. Look at that backdrop. That's what they're seeing. I've been referring to this as our red carpet division because two of the four former champions competing in this year's field of 72 are right here in the girls 12-13. They're sitting in the 10th and 11th slots, and right now I think they're feeling a little bit of pressure.
And I'm sure they know who they're going against too. They're no stranger to it, and they know there's some success already there in their 12 shooter lineup. I can remember, I think when I was 10 or 11, maybe 11, and made it back to nationals, I was a former champion and was also going against another former champion in my age group, and her last name was Boltz with a G. So it was Boltz versus Boltz, and it was like, couldn't have had any closer last names, two former champions. And if I remember right, I think she edged me out with first the year that I got second, so that was pretty cool.
All right, this is Jada Bosch from Yuma, Arizona, lodge number 476. That one of the advantages going deeper in the lineup of 12 is you get to see what your margin for error is before you start shooting. But right now, there really isn't much of a margin for error. Lots can change in the second set of 15. Of course, that 11th shot is key and always difficult to make. But
well, and I'll be excited to see what Jada does here because I had the chance to rebound for her a little bit yesterday and had a great conversation with her dad. And they seem like a basketball family. And, you know, I was watching her. She rarely misses. So she's, as you can see, locked in. Her eyes don't leave the hoop very often.
Yeah, if you were to look up a picture or look up concentration in the dictionary, you would see a picture of Jada right there. Look at that face.
And it's funny, too, to be at the practice gym with all these kids yesterday. I can remember, you know, when I would head to the gym every day with my parents, my dad. I wouldn't leave until I hit X amount of shots in a row. You know, it was, okay, let's hit 10 and then leave. And then, you know, if you miss, you got to start over. Or let's make 5 in a row and then we can leave. And I always had to end on a swish. You know, it's the best sound that you can hear as the ball goes through the basket. So I was never leaving if it wasn't a swish. And some of these kids had the same rituals, so it was kind of cool to see.
Look, she takes a deep breath there to compose herself, and now she's locking in again. Six shooters in. We've got 2 10s and 2 9s right now. And here comes Ryan Sheehan from Woonsocket, Rhode Island Lodge, number 850. She is a returning finalist. She was here in Chicago in 2019. Kaya Pomerantz from Weehawken, New Jersey Lodge, number 1456. She actually had her roughest round of the tournament at regionals where she only hit 16 and then needed to shoot off to advance. She hit 8 of 10 to get out of that region, make it here where anything can happen.
Her lucky charm is her her Steph Curry socks. I sure hope she's wearing those today.
There we go. There they are, Steph Curry socks. All right, here we go. Kaya shooting for score. We should point out, those of you who are just tuning in for the first time today, the scores we're giving you are unofficial. We've been accurate so far, but we are not the official scorers for the hoop shoot.
She might be the first girl that we've seen shoot in her jacket.
In her warm-ups, yeah. I would imagine that would feel a little bit awkward, huh?
I mean, you can see the other girls, they kind of might put it back on once they get done with their round and they're waiting, but you don't see it too often where they have long sleeves on shooting. Whatever works, though, right? As long as the ball goes in the basket.
All right, a nice round of 10 for Kaya there. I think that's our third nine.
And a good bounce back after her miss early on.
This is Savannah Alt from Frostburg, Maryland Lodge number 470. She's taking it, looks like the full five shots, warm-up shots.
And that's another thing I'd love to kind of ask some of these shooters after watching them today. You know, like, is there any certain reasoning why you take the amount of warm-up shots that you do? Obviously, you can have up to five, but when it came to my warm-ups, I was always going to shoot three. I never wanted to go with five because then that means, like, I was probably going to try to make 15 in a row. And as we've seen in the former, you know, rounds and the age groups, that round of 15 is a little bit tougher than the round of 10. So my number was always three, and I'm sure other people have their own reasoning.
Yeah, she got a friendly bounce on that one.
You need those every once in a while.
Savannah's best round so far was at regionals where she shot 22. She was 19 out of 25 in each of the three other rounds.
And Savannah says that her biggest fan is her mom. And I did have the chance to meet Savannah and her mom the other night and had the chance to exchange the trading cards, which is a really cool aspect that the Hoop Shoot now has that I didn't get to experience when I was competing. But, man, have I collected them myself this year.
Got a nice sharp-looking backboard trading card.
With a good old picture when I was about probably 10 years old on there. I don't quite look the same.
Here's Bree Bessonet. She is one of our two former champ shooting in this division. She's from Copper County, Michigan, Lodge number 404. She won the girls 8-9 back in 2019. Sister Elise is on the backboard with you.
That is correct. Another family affair here with the Hoop Shoot with this family.
Now, I remember correctly, her parents, both parents, participated as kids also.
And as we've seen, Jim, you know, some of these girls are competing against girls that they've competed against before. You know, it's not the first time that they've seen each other. And that, you know, takes me back to my first year in 2006 when I ended up winning it. And then I believe my third year, I shot along with Katie McWilliams. And she went on to play basketball at Oregon State University. So it just kind of goes to show you. You don't know it at the time, but these girls can go on to do some pretty amazing things. You know, I shot against Tyra Buss in our region in Iowa City at regionals, and she went on to be Indiana's all-time women's basketball leading scorer. So it's kind of crazy. And, you know, we still stay in touch with each other, and still it's social media that allows that to be so easy these days. So it's pretty cool. Like I said, they don't know it now, but they'll be able to look back, and they'll all be in different places and achieving great things.
Well, Bree just achieved something pretty great right there. Perfect 10 in her first round. Here comes Inu Wang, our second champ in this division. She won same year as Bree. She won the girls 10-11. This is her final go and her fourth straight finals appearance.
She's what we call a veteran.
Yes, she is. But you were talking about the rivalries. It is fun to see that when these kids run into each other. We saw it in previous divisions today, like in the girls 10-11, the last contest we followed, where you had the entire podium from the previous year competing against each other again.
Yep.
You had the two girls who tied for second shooting back-to-back in that division.
Just adds a little bit of competitive nature to the competition.
It's a friendly rivalry, but it is a rivalry, right?
Well, and like I touched on earlier, I always encourage the kids, you know, none of them are probably getting to know each other quite yet, but once the nerves are all out after the competition is over, my favorite part was always just finally getting comfortable around those that I was shooting against, and that's where those friendships form, and, you know, our families getting to know each other is also another thing, and still staying in contact with those families today. So, you know, I always encourage the kids when I'm interacting with them, hey, as soon as the shoot's over, all is said and done, time to be friends. You know, get out of your comfort zone. Don't be shy. That's where the fun happens.
Yeah, after this contest, about an hour from now, it's going to be like releasing a pressure valve. And then they're just kids having a good time.
And dinner will be eaten tonight versus breakfast this morning, where I'm sure there were full plates of food sitting there when they left.
Some of them might even eat some pizza after dinner, make up for that lost meal at breakfast.
That's right.
Our final shooter in the field is Kinsey Wark, sponsored by Corvallis, Oregon, Lodge number 1413. And Corvallis, Oregon is where the hoop shoot started way back in 1946. This, of course, is the 50th anniversary as a national program, but the program has been around much longer.
So what a cool year to be representing that lodge. And I'm pretty sure Kinsey might be repping her Dippin' Dot socks today. She says that's her lucky charm.
I hope she remembered to pack them. Yep, there they are, Dippin' Dots.
Look at those. I don't like to think that I'm superstitious, but looking back, every single competition, I had to wear the same exact outfit from head to toe. Everything was the same, and usually it worked out, but I always, you know, if something was missing, that wasn't good, but.
Was it Michael Scott who said, I'm not superstitious, but I'm a little stitious?
Just a little.
Well, this is shaping up to be the hoop-a-nanny we thought it would be. Through the first round, we've got three tens, three nines, and a couple of eights. Anybody's ball game.
Like I said, there's some experience here, so they know what they're into, and we figured it would be pretty competitive. Now, Addie's been sitting for a little bit. We'll see how the set of 15 goes.
Well, there's the old number 11. So we've just been told we had a perfect score on the boys' side. That's our first perfect score of the day. Brendan Smith from Marietta, Georgia Lodge, number 1657.
We'll see if anybody down the line can match that.
Of course, that's an unofficial result. But it looks like we will not have a tie for the Getty Paulo Award, which goes to the best overall boy and girl shooters on the day. We had a tie going into this division with two boys having shot 24, but that has been broken. two Getty Paolo Award winners will join the Elks for their national convention in Atlanta, which I believe is a pretty short trip for Brendan, who's from Marietta, Georgia.
You know, I can relate to how those two boys who shot 24 probably feel. The year that I won it when I was 9, in the first age group, shot 24 out of 25 and was hoping that I'd be the top girl. And then here comes Carly Samuelson, which I'm sure everybody involved with the hoop shoot knows the Samuelson last name. And she got me with a perfect score, I believe, in the 12 and 13-year-old age group. So I know exactly how those two boys are feeling right now after they just thought they might have had it locked in.
Right, the hometown hero, Addie Elliott, faltered a little bit in the second round of 15. Finishes with a 19, I believe. Here comes Cadence Graham, working on an 8. All right, Cadence stakes her claim to first with a 21, pushing Addie into second for the moment. Here comes Abby Gomez again. She's working on a 7.
See her shake the hands a little bit. She missed that first shot back. For those watching again, you know, you're sitting there between your first round and your second round for quite some time, and again, that second set of 15 can be something to adjust to just based on sitting there. And I always had to make sure I wipe my hands on my shorts, you know, shake it off a little bit, get back up there, and that 11th shot, the first shot of the 15, is always sometimes the hardest.
So she seems to have adjusted, but those three opening misses in this set means she's likely going to need some help if she wants to leave home with one of the big trophies.
as we've seen pretty consistently throughout the age groups here, it's all about finding a rhythm in this second set. You know, you can step up and shoot your 10, but then coming back for that 15 after seeing everybody else maybe sink more than you wanted them to can be a challenge.
Your colleagues on the backboard are doing a nice job of trying to keep the shooters in the rhythm today. They're all serving as our rebounders, and they're getting that back ball back to the line judge quickly, which helps. Here comes JC Hlitska, who was perfect in that first set. If she can stay perfect, there will be only one other shooter she has to worry about. But she, too, struggles with that 11th shot.
Wiping the hands.
Yep. Does have some breathing room because 21 is a score to beat currently, but there's a lot of people in this field still shooting after her who have tens and nines.
Not to jinx it at all, but she's had a great response from yep. that first shot. And after missing the first one, all you're thinking is to hopefully sink the next 14.
Right. Make yourself as hard as possible to beat. Last one, she got a bounce like that. She ripped off beautiful swishes next few shots, and then she did it again. Well, 13 out of 15, 23 is now our mark to beat. Our next two shooters are working on nines, so. This is Maddie Holmes from Beaumont, Texas. She needs to be perfect to keep pace with JC. She finishes the string here. She can put herself in second for the moment. All right, Cadence at 21 is now safe for the moment, for the time being, with her in second place. There's JC Hletzka. All she can do at this point, JC, is sit and hope. She's done all she can, getting that 23, and now she's got to wait while these last seven shooters take their shots. And Jada Bosch is one that can beat her. We saw her looking so determined in that first set of 10. She's sitting on a 9.
And if you watch Jada, her eyes and her head is not hardly leaving side of the basket.
She now has no margin for error. She needs these 14 to force a shoot off her first. Look at the way she spins the ball.
Is that going the opposite way then?
It looks like, unless you're in Australia, in which case it's normal. She recovered nicely from that first miss, just like we saw with JC. She just locks in. Look, she never stops looking at that net. That's what she's thinking about.
That's one of the first things that I noticed yesterday, you know, being with her at the practice gym and just having the conversation with her dad. I was just watching her shoot, and I'm like, holy cow, she's one of the most, like, focused shooters that I've watched. Pretty impressive for, you know, being this age.
Trying to finish strong with these last four and put herself in second with 22. But there are still a few more girls who can have something to say about that final podium.
I think I witnessed Jada make at least like 25 straight yesterday. So, I mean, that goes to show you these girls are more than capable of making the free throws. It's just anybody can have a bad day at any given time, and you just hope that it's not today.
Right. So she'll sit down with the 22 and wonder if that is going to be good enough. And we got Ryan Sheehan coming up. She's working on, what do we have, right? 6?
Haven't seen a whole lot of makes on this first shot back.
Yeah, so far it's only been Kate and Scram.
And Ryan still has another year, you know, to go in the hoop shoot. So she said her favorite part was the process of practicing and developing confidence to shoot successfully. You know, hopefully she can go back and, even though if she doesn't walk away with the trophy today, use that to her favor and come back next year.
This is Kaya Pomerantz, also working on a 9. These next three shooters all have something to say about the final podium, depending on how they shoot. And for Kaya, it was the 12th shot, not the 11th one.
That's a cool little warm-up jacket that New Jersey gets. And boy, have those travel suits evolved since I've been shooting. Mine didn't look anything, you know, compared to what they have now. I think mine was a nice white satin jacket.
Sharp.
Which is kind of funny just to look back and laugh at now.
So Kaya just fell out of a possibility of first place there with that mess. Needs all of these to put herself in a tie for second. So with a 21, that puts her in a current tie for third. Here comes Savannah Ault. Savannah Ault working on an 8. She needs all 15 to put herself in a tie for first. She won't get it. 11th one does her in as well. On the boys' side, we've been told there will be a 5-way shootout for third.
So if we have a 5-way shootout for third, we had the perfect 25 of 25 for first. Curious to see what that second place number is.
We're looking at 23 and then 5 tied with 22 on the boys' side.
Some impressive shooting.
Yep. Meanwhile, here in the girls 12-13, there are still two shooters who can catch JC in first. One of them is Bree Bussinen, who's sitting on a perfect 10. And then our last shooter is Kinsey Wark, working on an 8.
And Jim, as you know, viewers can see, each person on the floor has a big role. But what they might not know is there's the ref, you know, over to the side a little bit. Maybe tell them what she's
up to.
So
she just grabbed a rebound, and her actual function there is to count the dribbles. Hoop shooters may dribble the ball no more than 4 times before shooting. And that's her role, is counting the dribbles.
Which isn't a technical that we see all that often.
No, it's pretty rare. By the time they get here, the hoop shooters, that's ingrained pretty well in their heads that they can't dribble more than 4 times. Here comes Bree Bessonen. She's working on a perfect 10. She's got a margin for error here. She can afford to miss one shot and still end this thing.
The first one didn't phase her.
Yep. Both of our sisters have competed in the hoop shoot, and I believe both of them have made it to the national finals. Well, that's the one, that's the margin for error. If she misses another one, the best she can do is a tie for first. She's from Copper County, or Copper Country, Minnesota, but she's looking to go home with gold today, not copper. I think we just got a shot at JC sitting on the bench, and all she can do right now is watch. Well, she doesn't even want to watch. There she is. Look at that. Wow, okay, so this is it. If she hits this next one, she is our champion, and it would be her second hoop shoot championship. And there it is.
Couldn't have ended on a better note than that. What a strong finish.
Yep. I believe the best Inu can do right now is a tie for fourth place, I think. But she wants to finish strong. This is her final appearance in the hoop shoot. She's aging out. She's been to 4 straight national finals. She's won 1 championship. Been a great competitor. Thank you. dribble. Connor had to get another rebound. She, by the way, is Dee Dee Morford from Montana. Her husband, John, will soon become the new regional director from the Northwest Central region, replacing Vern Larson, who is retiring after having volunteered for 49 years with the Hoop Shoot program in some capacity.
And the Hoop Shoot will definitely miss Vern.
Yeah, he's...
he's another one that I...
yeah.
Familiar face from when I was competing, and it's so cool to see, you know, these members just still giving back and still contributing to the awesome experience that they give these kids. And it's also cool to come back and, you know, give back and help at the national finals. And, you know, not only do we remember them, but they remember us. So
right.
That's pretty special as well.
Right. And here comes our final shooter, Kinsey Wark. Again, Corvallis, Oregon. She's working on, I believe, an 8. She can force a tie for second if she hits all 15 of these. Can she get past this 11th shot hurdle? I think only 4 of these 12 girls made that 11th shot.
I'm not joking when I say it gets you.
So your goals constantly shift in the contest, right? She was hoping to force a tie for second. Now she's hoping to force a tie for third. She needs all of them, all the rest of these shots.
And again, competing under pressure is something that these kids take away at such a young age, too. You know, even at the 8 and 9-year-old level, you're sitting there thinking, like, shoot, I just missed one or two. I can't afford to miss another one. And to put that pressure on yourself to have to make the rest, you know, a lot of kids probably can't say that they've been in that position before. Maybe later on down the line, they'll have a game on the line where they're at the free throw line and think, this isn't my first rodeo.
Yeah, or a high pressure situation in another sport that they play, or in the classroom or a future job or whatever. And it's, there aren't going to be too many situations in your life, regardless of what you end up doing, that are going to be, you know, as pressure packed as the finals of an Elks National Hoop Shoot. If you can do that, not too many things you can't do. So it looks like when she's done, we'll be wrapped up with the girls 12-13. We can then cut over and cover the 5-way shoot off for third on the boys' side. We'll try to bring ourselves up to speed to figure out what's happening over there for you.
Yeah, this will be exciting.
Yeah. And that's the toughest shoot off, right? Usually with a shoot off for first, even second, most of the time you're going home with something, right? But when it's a shoot off for third.
Yep.
That's a tough pill to swallow. All right, so we're already in. It looks like the third round here, maybe? If I'm reading this correctly, and it's the same two guys who dueled for first last year.
Wow.
Tommy Goodell and Sam Bauer. Now they're dueling for third. This is Tommy Goodell here. It's his third straight finals appearance. He finished third in boys 8-9 in 2019. Last year he won the boys 10-11 virtual conclusion. And he came into the finals this year having missed only two of his 100 regulation shots in the first four rounds of the tourney. So I think that was Tommy shooting first, and I think it was a five, right?
I didn't see him miss.
So now comes Sam. He's got to match that. This is – looks like the shot tracker is saying Tommy missed one. The Bauers are a big hoop shoot family from Nampa, Idaho. His cousin was a national finalist. His father and all his father's brothers had competed in the hoop shoot for many years. And his uncle was a former champion in, I believe, 1997, Jacob Bauer.
Runs in the family.
Yep.
And that always helps, too. You know, I was speaking with some of the parents yesterday at the practice gym, and I mean, some of them had no idea what they were getting into, didn't know that the experience would be half of what it is. And again, you truly just don't understand until you get involved in it, and making it this far is a whole new level. So the fact that it runs in their family, they know well aware and know what they're getting into.
So a little measure of revenge in their friendly rivalry between Tommy Goodell and Samuel Bauer. I'm sure he had wished for gold, having lost the shoot-off for gold last year to finish second to Tommy. But this year, in their shoot-off for third, Samuel hits 15 out of 15, beating Tommy, who hit 14 out of 15. Finished fourth and fifth. It's Eddie Duffy, who hit 9 out of 10 in the shoot-off. I saw him shooting at the gym yesterday. He didn't miss many shots. Matthew Brown with 8 of 10, and then Jackson Jones dropped out in the first round of that shoot-off with hitting 3 of 5. I believe we have a – do we have a shoot-off for the Getty Powell on the girl side, and that's it, right?
I believe we will. We'll have Bree, who has 24.
And the – girls
and Emerson,
yeah,
in the 8 and 9 year old division
had 24 also, right?
She had 24.
So that's the only thing left to do, is figure out who's the best overall girl shooter and who will be joining us in Atlanta for the Elks National Convention, along with Brendan Smith, making a short trip from Marietta, Georgia. Quite a contest today, Lakyn. What do you think? Bring back memories for you?
Absolutely. You know, it's been fun reflecting, and I think this whole weekend and you know, coming in on Thursday and then greeting the families as they get there, it all brings back so many memories. And getting to do this with the other backboard members is, heck, I even competed against one of them as well. So it's just fun. It's fun to interact with the families, the kids, being able to be in their shoes and, you know, share my thoughts with them. And now we're looking forward to a night of fun, hopefully.
So why don't we cut to contest announcer Dennis Sabo, who will announce the winners for us.
We'd like to turn your attention to center court as we hand out awards for first, second, and third place in the girls' 12 and 13-year-old division. In third place, with a score of 22 out of 25, and representing Yuma, Arizona, number 476, it's Jada Bosch, ladies and gentlemen. The national runner-up with a score of 23 out of 25, representing Harrison, Arkansas, number 2311, it's J.C. Halitska. Your girls 12-13 national champion with a score of 24 out of 25 and representing Copper Country, Michigan, number 404. Put your hands together for national champion Bree Bessonen. Now we need regional directors Lester Collins, Mike Stewart, and Harley Birchmeyer, please. And ladies and gentlemen, don't leave after this presentation because we will have another shoot-off for the Girls Getty Powell Award. So we'll explain that in just a minute after we hand out the boys' awards, but there's more free throws to come. In the boys' division, 12-13, our third place winner with a score of 22 out of 25 and 15 of 15 on three tiebreakers. And representing Nampa, Illinois, 1389, Samuel Bauer. Nampa, Idaho. Yeah. Nampa, Idaho Lodge, 1389, Samuel Bauer. The national runner-up with a score of 23 out of 25. And representing Weymouth, Braintree, Massachusetts, number 2232. Give it up for Cole Madden. And your national champion turned in the only perfect score of the day, girls or boys, 25 out of 25, representing Marietta, Georgia, number 1657. He is your national champion, Mr. Brendan Smith.
Brendan, you are also the Get Boys Getty Powell Award winner this year. You were the best boy shooter in this contest today.
Twelve, 13-year-olds, you are all dismissed, but this round of applause one more time is for all of you. Congratulations, Bree. You may stay, Bree. Guys, you are dismissed as well. Congratulations to all of you.
Okay, I'll explain to everybody the rules for the Getty Powell Best of the Best shoot-off. At this time, we'll have a shoot-off between the
So we're looking at the final scores on the girls' 12-13 side. Our winner, was Bree Bessonen, our second Hoop Shoot National Championship, 24 out of 25. And second was J.C. Hlitska. Been here before. Went home with the hardware this time with the silver, 23 out of 25. And in third was Jada Bosch, who was locked in all day, 22 out of 25, to take home the bronze trophy.
So we had a few contestants that were no strangers to the national finals and, you know, what it's like at this level. The experience looked to pay off for them.
Going back to Monday Madness, when we talked about the red carpet division, who was going to own the red carpet? We wondered whether it would be one of the former champs, one of the returnees, would it be a newcomer? It was Bree Bessonen, one of those two champs we were watching, winning her second title. And she still has another year left of eligibility. So what's going to happen now is they're going to shoot. We've got the 8 and 9-year-old girl winner, who we did not get to see, Emerson Hess. And Bree Bessonen, and they're going to shoot in the order that they shot. So Emerson was the fourth shooter in the 8-9 girls, so she will be shooting first here. It's going to be sets of five shoot-offs. Emerson, you know, all day we've talked about what effect shooting in this large arena with that open background would have. And you look at Emerson's scores. Her best round was the Lodge at 20 coming into this, 18 at district, 18 at state, 19 at regional. Shows up in this massive arena with the open backdrop there, and she misses only one shot.
It's rising to the occasion if I've ever seen it.
Maybe the problem was she didn't have large enough gyms to shoot in before.
And it's been a while now since Emerson has shot, so it should be interesting. Will Emerson be getting any warm-ups?
I think we allow warm-ups, and we're not exactly sure.
Because I don't think Bree needs them, but we'll see.
Bree's on fire. It's been a while since Emerson was on fire, right? Now, both of these contestants are part of the Great Lakes Regional Team. One of the awards we have, and this, again, is new since you competed, Lakyn, is a team award. It's named the Kronk Award after our predecessors, the national director of the program, Cam and Linda Kronk. We're a wonderful team. And the team award, the Kronk Award, goes to the region that hits the most regulation shots in the national finals. And the Great Lakes region, with
they've
these
shown
two,
up.
Yeah, these two, a second place finisher in the boys 8-9, they're going to be tough to beat. So they're going to give her 5 warm-ups here.
And for those who did not watch the 8-9 and may not be familiar, the 8-9-year-olds do shoot a few feet in front of the regulation free throw line.
Getting a lot of loft on that shot. All right, here we go. Emerson Hess shooting for score. She's from Vincennes, Indiana Lodge, number 291. Nope, a little confusion here. It's been 3 years since we've done an in-person final, so we're all a little bit rusty. Okay, this is for score. Looks like there's a little bit of confusion over how many warm-up shots she took.
Then she sits down, and if Bree wants to have 5 warm-ups, she can have 5. And then both of them sit down, and they shoot 10, and then sit down. The other one gets up, shoots 10, and then 15, no warm-ups. It's not 25, it's they just shoot 5 in the increments.
Thank you. Okay, so okay, I think this is our third round of five here. They're so far, they're in lockstep. Okay, the door is open for Bree here. She wanted that one. Right here, she hits this one. She is her Girl Getty Powell Award winner.
Give it up for Emerson Hessen, Bree Bessonen, and our Getty Powell shoot-off.
Great shooting by both of them today.
Yeah, that was something.
Here for a second.
So that'll... That'll do it for the Hoop Shoot Finals, Lakyn. That was a lot of fun, right?
That was a lot of fun. Yeah, thank you for having me, Jim. This was a great experience. Again, just getting to reflect on what we now call the good old days and, you know, getting to talk through the experiences that I had that these kids are now going through. And we've got a good night ahead of us with the awards banquet. And then hopefully they all become some good friends at the end of it.
That's right. That's it. About the awards banquet tonight, we'll be handing out those big trophies and – looking forward to that. It's been fun. Thank you to everybody for tuning in.
Those trophies might just be just as tall as some of those yep. other kids. Yep.
Okay. Yep. Again, thanks so much for tuning in. Good night, everybody. Let's watch some highlights from the contest as we fade out. That's next year, what do you say?
Absolutely.